Hola, mi nombre es Javier Couso, soy investigador asociado de COES. Y hoy día tenemos con nosotros al profesor Tom Ginsburg de la Universidad de Chicago, que es un experto mundial en construcción constitucional. En Chile, desde hace 3 semanas atrás, estamos hablando en noviembre 12 de 2019. El gobierno anunció un proceso constituyente. En 2013 hubo un intento iniciado por la candidatura de Michelle Bachelet, pero que fracasó. Ahora pareciera ser que nos encaminamos a un proceso constituyente que sí va a funcionar y queríamos preguntarle a Tom, que tiene mucha experiencia en diversos procesos constituyentes, algunos, un panorama mundial sobre esta temática y cómo las experiencias chilenas se insertan en aquello. Tom, thank you for being here. Let's start with a very basic question. You know a bit about Chile, and you have mentioned that Chile has a very peculiar status when it comes to constitution building because it's not coming out of a dictatorship or we have not experienced a revolution. And it's rather unique, the fact that we are actually thinking about having a new constitution. What thoughts comes to your mind when you assess this particular case?
Right. Well, first of all, I think Chile has always had a somewhat distinctive constitutional history. It's maybe the country in Latin America with the most stable constitutions going back to 1833. So it's a little bit different than the other countries in the region in this respect, as well as many others. When we look around the world, usually constitutions are written after some massive revolution, sometimes after as part of a peace process, after a really full civil war. Sometimes there are very just small technical reforms that produce new constitutions, and other times that they're produced by occupations, many different kinds of circumstances. I'm trying to think of a circumstance in which you're trying to do a pretty major reform in response to demonstrations. But the politics, the political system is still quite intact. And so you're trying to use the political system as it currently exists. Some people would like to see a very major constitutional reform in Chile. And so can you do that in this way? And I think, it's quite possible that it can work. If so, it would be very much like the Pinochet Constitution in the sense that that was a rather distinctive constitution itself. It was formed in dictatorship to return the country to democracy, but really bounding the political process. There's not that many constitutions in that category either. So Chile is going
Oh, I
its own
see.
way.
And in terms of content, because that's we people say that the Chilean constitution, the Pinochet constitution, is biased towards conservative policies in economics and as well as in social issues. In your opinion, what do you think it's the state of the art in terms of the content that a liberal democracy should have in its constitution?
Right, so constitutions are like anything else. Things change, ideas change, and they usually reflect the time that they're written in very much. And the world, of course, very different than it was in 1980. So if you were to go to a country, random country, writing a new constitution today, you would see very different institutions. First of all, you'd see a constitutionalized fourth branch of government, special institutions just to ensure accountability and to make sure that the other branches of government are functioning properly. You'd probably see a little more attention to the environment. I know it's mentioned, but much more on that these days. You would probably see much more about special marginalized communities. That's one of the trends we see as well. And so these and other things are what's reflected in modern constitutions. I think of constitutions as like a technology, where you would ideally not use a technology that was invented 100 years ago or 200 years ago. You need mechanisms to update and to bring these new ideas in. And so I expect that that'll be a large part of the discussion, those kind of issues.
And of course, when a new constitution is, programmed and is a announced itinerary, at this time of your visit to Chile, we are about to set up the mechanisms. And there is a lot of distrust of political parties, and there is a lot of willingness to have independence in the constituent body. If the process goes on, we will have most likely a fully elected constituent body. But the proportional system, electoral system we have, it's geared to allow political parties to have the bulk of the constituents. But if you were interested in having independence, have a chance, a fair chance to be represented in the constituent body, what do you think is a good mechanism to achieve that?
Right, so I should just say in general, we see all over the world increasing distrust of political parties. Traditional parties' membership is going down. We have the rise even of what you might call anti-party parties, like the Five Star Movement in Italy, which is, you know, says it's a movement. In fact, it's a party, but no coherent ideology or structure. And we see a huge rise in the number of people who say that they're independent of the various political forces. So, you know, that's where the people are. Parties are really still important for democracy. We can't even imagine a modern democracy without parties. But how do you at least get those voices into the process? So in constituent assembly elections, we usually, in most countries, would allow independents to run in the various constituencies. In the Chilean case, we're using district-based elections. I don't see any special need to do anything other than allowing independents to run to make sure that they have the fair chance as anyone else. There's no reason to advantage them particularly, but also no reason to exclude them. And we'll see. One point about that is sometimes when you allow independents or people say that they want independents to participate, the people who end up getting those seats are people who have other forms of recognition. Celebrities can then take those seats, who may not necessarily have great ideas or much, you know, to contribute in a substantive way.
And of course, after 3 years of the Me Too movement globally and in Chile last year, there is a lot of concern about having some gender parity in the constituent body.
Yeah.
How would you envision the best way to achieve at least some important representation of women in that body?
Right. So there's various things one can do in any electoral system. I know that Chile has a quota in the normal electoral system for political parties, but that might not be enough to guarantee full parity, and usually is not unless the quota is designed in a very particular way. So in some systems, what you would do is you'd have the regular election, but then you might have some supplemental seats to increase the size of the body to get to parity. So let's say you have the normal process, it produces 150 people of, and it's 40% women. Then you would allow the parties to nominate people on a proportional basis, women, to get to true parity. So there are things that can be done on a technical level. I suspect that that if you just use the existing electoral system, it will reflect the gender balance of the current parliament, not parity.
And to finish with this side, I mean, the integration of the constituent body, in Chile we have a long history of mistreatment of indigenous peoples. And in that case, there is the notion is that they should have ensured positions in the constituent body, not just the chance to get elected, but to have secure membership. Not too much. In Chile, it's about 5 to 10% of the population are from indigenous background, but there's been talk about 3% of the entire body to be secure for those indigenous minorities. What's your thought about that?
Well, in general, this is the trend in constituent bodies, is to have some special seats for tradition, for marginalized communities. There's a number of ways you could do that. You could, for example, have a special electoral constituency where only in this country the Mapuche could vote for some Mapuche representatives and have that on the ballot at the same time. It's quite
possible. Wouldn't that be considered, wouldn't that be considered to be something that goes against the notion of one person, one vote, that's so important for liberal democracy as a concept?
Well, I think that we often have these kind of dual voting constituencies where in a system where you have PR representatives and electoral districts, people get two votes in some sense. And so I don't know that it's one vote for two people is not necessarily a problem. The other thing you could do, of course, is just to have some appointed representatives from this community that are appointed by the president or something like that to make sure that the community has a voice. And a third thing you could do is if that the constituent body's structure is already set, you could allow at least some supplemental non-voting you know, observers, observer members to bring the voice of these communities into the discussions at the very minimum. So, you know, again, this is the trend. I see that the current plan doesn't really talk much about this because you're using the existing electoral law.
So, and while the constituent body is doing its work, do you see mechanisms to have some feedback from civil society while the constituent body is deliberating?
Yeah. Well, of course, this is absolutely essential. It's not the case that you elect the constituent body and they disappear for 2 years and then come out with a magic product. There has to be continuous flow of information, even though, of course, the constituent body must be negotiating and, you know, with some privacy. But that doesn't exclude the possibility of information flow. So you can have inputs. You could ask groups to provide their ideas for what should be in the Constitution. You could have public meetings, communication about how the process is going. And also, of course, you can have channels by which information comes from the constituent body out to civil society. So I expect that will happen. It's a really necessary part of the process, because if you don't have that, then sometimes you might have civil society and the public groups going completely outside the process to the street and such, which could, of course, be very disruptive. So it's very important that they think of ways to have a continuous flow of information both ways.
I see. And another issue that's typically, I mean, brought to the, I mean, captures the attention of people who are interested in the process is, of course, this notion of having a supermajority in order to get any decision to be binding in the constituent body. Let's say, instead of having the majority plus one, to have, let's, 3/5 or even higher quorums to get a clause of the new constitution being adopted, or the whole constitution being adopted. That's one of the most intense debates we are having at the moment in Chile.
Of course, in a principle, in a constitutional democracy, you want the voting rule to sort of correlate with the importance of the issue at hand. So if we're talking about something like the budget, well, 50% plus one is fine. But if you're talking about the fundamental rules for a society, it's not crazy to have a supermajority. In fact, it's probably advisable that you have a two-thirds majority. After all, when you're using the ordinary electoral process to elect the constituent assembly, 50% plus one is not really any different than the ordinary legislature. Might as well just use the legislature. But I think it's a good idea to try to get as much consensus as possible. At the same time, you can't allow groups to hold out and to refuse to participate in the process as a way of derailing what the vast majority of the country wants. So it's a delicate balance.
And how do you, what if, because there's a paranoia in Chile that, let's say, people who don't want to have a new constitution would do exactly that. Basically keep their 1/3 plus one vote and basically boycott the, it's a paranoid paranoia that's going around. It's not necessarily what will happen, but it's there.
Yeah.
The notion that a group that basically is happy with the current constitution would be part of the constituent body just to boycott a new constitution.
Well, presumably such a group would be punished in the polls, either in that election or thereafter, and they would anticipate that they would, you know, be seen as blocking what the vast majority of the people want if the draft is a good one. So, you know, we'll have to see if that plays out. I think you have to carefully distinguish between what groups are saying now and what they will, how they will behave once the process starts to go forward. Because I'm not sure that you really want to be seen as a blocking a project which the vast majority of the people want. You, who wants to govern a country when you're a permanent minority and the vast majority isn't really accepting your legitimacy? So, but I don't know, that's a matter of politics, and we're gonna have to see how these elections play out.
It's fascinating you mentioned this notion of punishment by the electorate, and that speaks to legitimacy issues. In Chile, one of the important reasons why we are in this constituent process at all is because of the perceived illegitimacy of the constitution we have. In your experience, looking to other experiences in the world, how important is legitimacy for a new constitution or in order to change an existing one?
Right. Well, I think in Chile it is very important. And this is, of course, a source of great political division here. The fact is, this is an authoritarian constitution. It was produced by an authoritarian. And that symbolism carries great weight, painful weight, for many, many people in this society. And so even if you don't change a word of the new constitution, having a new founding, having a new constitution, would have massive symbolic importance, because people would feel like it was theirs. They chose the institutions themselves as a matter of free choice. And, you know, I often think of the great idea of the Thomas Jefferson, our founding father, who said, the dead should never govern the living. Every generation should choose its own institutions. There's virtue in that process, just in an independent of the content.
And Tom, are there many constitutions that have been left in place by an authoritarian government?
Well, usually, of course, there is a transformation. And there are a few others in this category. I mentioned Turkey before Erdogan came to power, was governed by basically a military constitution, somewhat similar to here in Chile. Panama today, interestingly, is governed by the 1972 constitution, which was produced by the general, the authoritarian dictator of the time. And now, quite similarly to Chile, there were people on the streets who were demanding a new constitutional reform for many of the same reasons. The symbolic discussion is part of it, but even more important in Panama are the social demands of exactly the same type that we see here in Chile.
And I have a last question, because it's been very informative, but I wonder, there's a lot of expectations in Chile that a new constitution will bring about fast answers to social demands.
Yeah.
And what can a constitution deliver, in your opinion, in that score?
Well, this is a very important point. You know, at the end of the day, a constitution is just a piece of paper. And one has to be conscious both of what constitutions can do, but also what they cannot do. They don't reorganize the entire society. Rather, what they do is they direct the political structure to try to achieve certain goals. They help to organize the political structure for accountability. And very importantly, they provide resources for mobilization. And that's where the process of making the Constitution can connect with the outcomes afterwards. Mm-hmm. So we have some examples where you have mobilization by a particular group for a particular, let's say, a right to health in the Constitution. And they fight really hard for that in the Constitution. And then after the Constitution is adopted, those groups are intact and they can continue to fight for implementation of them. So it's really in the end about motivating politicians and mobilizing civil society to make constitutions work.
Not that the Constitution would set up a more robust welfare state, is just an opportunity to channel and catalyze social movements that would then mobilize society towards the satisfaction of these demands. That's the way I think about it.
And incentivizing politicians to deliver on these promises.
Another question, a last question I have, has to do with the exit referendum, the referendum that's going to be held after the constituent body draft a new constitution. We know that in other constituent processes it was not used, because it was already understood that the people drafting the constitution were popularly elected, they were represented, therefore the people was represented. But we have this ratifying referendum. I wonder, what's your understanding of the role of these exit referendums?
Right. Well, it's very interesting. In a lot of other processes, they use a referendum as an incentive for the Constituent Assembly to do its work. So in South Africa and Nepal, for example, the rule was, if you don't get a two-thirds vote or consensus in South Africa, then a majority, I think, could send it to the people for referendum. So it was an optional referendum, not required. And that, because the politicians didn't want to be seen as failing to achieve the people's mission, forced them at the end to make a consensus and come up with a constitution.
So
there was an optional referendum.
Had they not agreed on a full constitution,
yeah,
the rule was that this, what exactly was going to be posed to the people to say?
Yeah, I think it was a majority could send a draft to the constitution.
I understand. I understand.
And, you know, an alternative would be to re-elect the Constituent Assembly. That would be another thing. So, but what you guys have done is to have the referendum just blessing, you know, deciding up or down. And, you know, it's not obviously necessary from a democratic theory point of view. It's also not really necessary as a matter of Chilean political culture, because you have this long tradition of basically elite-produced constitutions. It's not a revolutionary culture where people are demanding things in the streets. Nevertheless, that's the system, so we're going to see how it happens. My suspicion is that that will not be the major problem, that if you can get to that far and you produce a decent draft, people will go for it.
Yeah.
So it's not a major constraint. But if I was thinking about this a month ago, I would have said I would think about how to use that referendum in a way to motivate the assembly to get the two-thirds.
I think. Well, Tom, thank you for your fascinating summary of what's going on around the world, and we shall be in contact if this constituent process goes further.
Let's hope there's more to talk about in the next couple of years.
Okay, thank you again. So this was Javier Couso for COES.